The good thing about coming from a totally unrelated industry was that I never labored under any delusions of competency. I knew that I was going to come in and pretty much be taking my lumps, and that's how it was at the beginning. I mean, we all were learning everything on the fly, so it was a very exciting time, but very stressful. Madam Rich co-founded Thrillist.com about 5.5, 6 years ago, and it's an email newsletter for guys with local city information that's all kind of breaking, and it's targeted, filtered down for, you know, a 28-year-old guy, someone post-college with a job, disposable income, not enough time
to
spend.
It was
a concept
that
my business partner and I came to as consumers rather than as potential entrepreneurs. I was sitting with Ben and asking him if he knew of a good place to take a girl on a first date, and we live in New York. And there are a million restaurants, and so he didn't really have any recommendations offhand. And you know, when I went to City Search and stuff like that, it was really hard to trust any of the information, because basically that was the same city guide for me as it was for my mom. And so what I thought was affordable and romantic probably isn't what she thinks of as trendy and cool, much less my great aunt Joan or whoever else is supposed to be reading this. And so we realized there were a ton of guys out there like us, like our college friends, who needed city information that would be filtered down for what they would really find to be important and delivered in a way that they would enjoy. And so from there, we realized there really wasn't anything like that, and we set about to creating it. And that was how
I still remember those
started.
Early days when we were tiny and read by almost no one. So
I'm always shocked when someone has heard of us, but the first time that someone asked me if I read Thrillist not knowing that it was my project, I was like, wow, like, people do know this thing, and it's not just my mom. You know, a lot of it was just recognizing that if someone didn't do this, I mean, if we didn't do this, someone else probably would. It was a good business. And I think both of us were kind of excited about the idea of not working for somebody.
The good thing about coming from a totally unrelated industry was that I never labored under any delusions of competency.
I knew that I was going to come in and pretty much be taking my lumps. And that's how it was at the beginning. I mean, we all were learning everything on the fly. So it was a very exciting time, but very stressful.
I was in a corporate job. I was testing software. And Ben was actually working, doing operations for a boutique hotel.
So it was both of our first businesses that we started, and so far so good. I would say to go and actually do it. You know, I've talked to a lot of would-be entrepreneurs who have an idea, and so I ask, you know, what's the website? What's your URL? And they don't have a site yet. And so it's one of those things where you got to just get out there and start doing it. And you know, I think a lot of people will get hamstrung by the idea that they've got to have this crazy big built-out site and blah blah blah. And really what it comes down to is, when it comes to starting something up, there's really a binary quality to it. You've either started something or you've not. And so if you've started something and it's still, you know, alpha phase, you still have started something. You're still an entrepreneur. And so that kind of binary relationship is something that I don't think enough people recognize.
Yeah, what is going on with that bell?
Yeah.
Is there someone giving away xylophones?
Yeah.